The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 340 of Skywalking Through Neverland. Just happy beeps. Happy beeps.
And we'll be partying like Wookiees and Red Snuggies.
Yeah, it'll be so much fun. Wait, where's New Alderaan?
What is that? You know, that'd be a spoiler.
If you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all.
I think kids are listening. Don't give them any ideas. And you know you'll get to the other side of it, so don't worry about it. Hakuna Matata.
Are you ready?
Off to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
Best day ever!
Secrets lair.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, Skywalkers! School is now back in session. But where did you learn most of what you use on a daily basis, your valuable life lessons? Well, if you're like us, then you learned them from watching Star Wars, Disney, and the Marvel films. So now go grab your Trapper Keeper, your compass, and a number two pencil, so we can welcome you to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
I am Richard Woloski, but now everyone please welcome my tangled wife, sweetie Sarah. All tangled up.
I know, by tangled you mean representing the film Tangled, and not, I'm not tangled up in anything.
Oh, that's not what I meant, but yeah, I guess you're wearing the Rapunzel shirt and headband, but that, I didn't even notice that until right now.
Oh, I see. Well, I'm confused. Do people still use number two pencils at school? I'm just wondering about this. I think everyone uses their iPads, maybe?
Right, but why not a number three? What is a number? So if there's a number, a number two pencil, right, then there must be a number one pencil.
There is. It's the,
and what's the difference?
So it's the lead, like how soft it is. So, like, I think number one pencils are harder, I want to say, and number two is just, like, the right softness for writing, and it's something like that. It's the hardness.
Three is, like, chalk?
I'm not sure. Yeah.
And then, whoever used a compass? I know in school they always told you to get a compass, and I had, like, a drawer full of them. It's like, what am I ever going to use this for? I've hurt myself many times on a compass.
Well, I know I had to use one of those big calculators, like the
Radio Shack ones?
Computational calculators, whatever they're called, and now you can just ask Siri.
Right.
What's the cosine tangent of whatever?
I think kids are listening. Don't give them any ideas.
Lead strength.
All right.
See?
Good. Yes. Now, how many of you actually had a Trapper Keeper?
Oh, I did.
I had a red one.
Oh, mine was teal. Oh. It was about the color of your shirt. It's very pretty.
Oh, I loved it because there are so many pockets, and you'd put something in a pocket, and then you'd lose it. Like, oh, I put this in some kind of a zippered pocket. Now I can't find it. But if you turn the Trapper Keeper upside down and turn it backwards, you got to look at it in a mirror, then you can find that pocket.
Well, I just got to say that Trapper Keepers have longevity because I used a Trapper Keeper in, like, middle school, which was about 12 years after you probably used a Trapper Keeper.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a long time for Trapper Keepers.
I may even still have my Trapper Keeper.
What?
I keep everything.
Okay.
And so, if I find it, I'm sure I'll find different things hidden in different pockets.
Okay. And Meredith is now the specialist on pencils.
Yep, she's in the Sky Chat, and she's giving us the rundown on pencil history.
Yeah, so...
And
so,
pencil facts.
So number one pencil is soft lead, and number three pencil is hard lead.
Boy, this really is a back-to-school episode.
Which means the number two pencil is just right.
There you go. All right, speaking of just right...
Yes! Skywalkers, welcome! We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. And so, even without all this talk about school, it's time to give you a big Wookiee hug. And then a little sprinkle of pixie dust. Because you are our family of Skywalkers. So thank you so much for joining us today, whether you're listening to us on the podcast, whether you're watching us on YouTube, or whether you're watching us live on Tuesdays at 5 p.m. Pacific. And so as we chat today, we will be referring to our Sky Chat, which are all the live watchers right now. So thank you, Skywalkers. Oh, and that's what we're going to call you, Skywalkers, because you're watching us.
And the sky chatters.
Yeah. Now, we are being sponsored by Small World Vacations, and they are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world. Right now, I'll have you know that some of my friends have used them, and right now, cruises are pretty cheap, like much cheaper than usual, because they have to fill them. So make sure to go to smallworldvacations.com for a no-obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you. My friend has almost booked her trip in October, so that's coming up, but you can get some good prices right now.
Now that the magic keys are available, you should be booking trips to Disneyland right now so we can we can have Skywalker meetups.
Yes, in fact, November, should we say?
Is that a sneak preview?
Well, yeah, so Skywalkers, if you do have your magic keys, we recommend that you reserve the date for November 17th, which is a Wednesday, right? That is, of course,
Life Day.
Yes.
More on Life Day in a few minutes.
And then also, as a backup,
So
November 20th.
We're in the planning stages now, but there also is word of maybe the weekend.
Okay, yes.
The weekend following the 17th, like the 20th or something.
Yeah, and the 20th is November. Saturday. So if you can, reserve both dates just you know, to be safe.
Yeah.
Right.
And we'll be partying like Wookiees and Red Snuggies.
Yeah. It'll be so much fun.
I've never seen so much discussion on pencils than right now in our Sky Chat.
Pencil
All right. So other than making a full complete circle, what else do you need a compass for?
Oh.
Attacking your enemies? Because those things are sharp. Ever get stuck by a compass?
Oh, yeah.
No, those things hurt. Why would they let kids run around with these sharp needles?
I feel like I've used a compass before for, like, planets. You know, like when you're learning
except
about the planets.
Except for making circles, perfect circles. Why else do you need a compass?
Well, that's why you need a compass. To make circles.
I had, like, 50 of these compasses. Every year they told you to get one.
No, you need a compass for not only making a circle, but also perfectly dividing the circle into an exact amount. Like, let's say you need a circle
Just eyeball it. That's
But
that's
see, you
fine.
Can. It's too hard.
Oh, hey, Chicken Fin's here. Chicken Fin says he loves the Skywalker meetups.
Yay!
Then, we are here waiting for you over here on the West Coast. We have our magic keys ready to go to Disney. Just let us know when you're here, everybody.
Yay.
All right, Chick Event, thanks for chiming in there. Oh, Corwin of Amber is here.
Oh, good.
Good.
Awesome.
All right, got a full crew. All right, now we are recording this from Long Beach, California on August the 31st, 2021. Now, in our Back to School special, we will be discussing the life lessons we've learned from the Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel films. And not a day goes by where we don't say, trust your feelings or just keep swimming.
Aww.
You know, those kind of life lessons that you do use on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what? In a way, you can say that we're homeschooled. Thanks, Disney Plus.
Oh, my goodness. Well, also on this episode, we have shout-outs and
things we want to share.
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
Hard to believe it's been 1 year since ForceFest. And to celebrate, we held a ForceFest reunion to celebrate our anniversary. So this virtual convention was held on August 29th through August 30th of 2020. And in ForceFest, we had 55 panels. We raised $3,200. And it was J.W. Rinzler's last recorded interview.
Yeah.
So this was a monumental event. And if you want to see our reunion, we put it up on YouTube.
Yeah, so the reunion just this past week featured over 30 people mm-hmm. who joined us in our Zoom conversation. It went about 2.5 hours.
Yeah, we thought at most an hour.
Mm-hmm.
But no.
Yeah, it was really cool because each person got to share their favorite memory of ForceFest. And then Spencer Jawitz of the Star Wars Celebration 2022 Facebook group, he gave some great info and tips on Star Wars Celebration and also the ForceChella event that they will hold before Celebration starts. And it's no longer called ForceChella.
No.
But he talks about that in the chat.
Yeah, what's that other Chella? The other cello that
Coachella
said, Coachella. Hey, you guys can't use the cello.
Yeah.
Take cello out of your force. So Frank D. Rich came on and talked about autograph collecting. There was a round of Force Fest and celebration trivia. We had a Star Wars treasure hunt.
Yes.
And we had like 2 hours of content we had to skip over just because
yes.
the night was getting late.
We were like, oh, I think we better skip this. So let's get to the games. Yeah, so it was really fun. And once again, this is available to watch on our YouTube channel. Just search our channel for ForceFest.
All right. Now, earlier, we made reference to Life Day. And let's circle back to Life Day. We just got our advanced copy of Life Day Treasury, Holiday Stories from a Galaxy Far, Far Away. And this is the book that has 8 short stories by Kevin Scott and George Mann. And oddly enough, this book doesn't tell you who wrote what story.
What?
There's 2 authors, but it never says who wrote what stories. But if you know these authors well enough, you can kind of guess who wrote what.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, and so far, I've read 3 stories,
uh-huh.
which for me is a lot.
That is a lot. I haven't picked it up because I was finishing another thing that we'll talk about. Mm-hmm. But go ahead.
All right, so I want to give a quick non-spoiler review of one of the stories to get a sense of what's in the store, okay?
Okay.
Now, this is called The Tree of Life by somebody. Doesn't say. I'm going to guess that it's Kevin Scott, because he's bringing back classic characters like he's done with Jackson and the Hoojibs. And in this story, we get Mala, Itchy, and Lumpy from the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Okay, hold on. Side note. Do you have the book right there?
It's in the bedroom. I was reading it last night while in bed.
Do you want me to? Let me grab it.
Oh, go grab it. Okay, go grab it.
Yeah.
So while you're doing that, I will give a short spoiler-free synopsis of the short story, The Tree of Life. Now, it's not said in the story, but this particular story does take place right after Return of the Jedi. The Galactic War is over, and Lumpy, who now wants to be called Waru, because that's the first part of his name, Lumpa Waru, instead of Lumpy, Lumpy's for kids, he's now a teenager, so he wants to be called Waru. And he's as tall as Mala, so we're thinking maybe a few years after Return of the Jedi. Okay, Sarah's holding the book there. That's a beautiful, beautifully illustrated book. So, in the story, it's Life Day once again, and an angsty Lumpy is upset that his dad is not there on Kashyyyk to help celebrate Life Day with him. As preparations are made for the celebration with the rest of the Wookiees, Chewie's father, Itchy, he remembers Life Day celebrations of the past when he was a young Wookiee. And Life Day was celebrated just once every 3 years, whereas now it's once a year. That kind of sounds like they're pulling from real life, because no doubt this is a reference to how the Star Wars films would come out every 3 years for the original and prequel trilogies, and then once a year, starting with The Force Awakens up to The Rise of Skywalker. That can't be a coincidence. So once Chewie's family, what is their last name? The Chewbacca clan. Itchy, Molly. Yeah, I'm used to saying Mala, Itchy, and Lumpy. So they get to the celebration, okay? And the Wookiees are hanging personal offerings on the Tree of Life. And this is getting way too much for Waru. And he just needs some breathing space and takes off. And guess what happens? I'm not going to tell you.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, because right here, this would be a spoiler if I told you what happens and who we meet as he takes off. So I'm not going to tell you that. But it's a very interesting story, very great message at the end. Just like all the stories, well, the three stories that I've read so far, great messages. And this story is only 16 pages long. It's the last story in the book. It's only 16 pages long, so it won't take you that long to get to the very ending. And other stories feature the Jedi Order, Jawas, Wookiees, and Ewoks. And this book, The Life Day Treasury, will be available on September the 7th.
Woohoo! Which is just around the corner. Should I read this introduction? It's not very long.
Sure.
Yeah?
Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to read the introduction here. So story time, everyone. Gather with your Snuggie. All right?
In your glowing orb.
Yes. A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. For millennia, Life Day was a festival celebrated only by the Wookiees of the planet Kashyyyk. It was centered on the fabled Tree of Life, thought by the Wookiees to be the source of all life, both on their lush green world and in the stars beyond. At its heart, the festival celebrated the core truths of Wookiee civilization: family, love, and happiness. The Wookiees held this meaning dear, even in their darkest days. So much so that Life Day spread throughout the New Republic and was adopted on worlds from the deep core to the outer rim and beyond. Its message was clear: no matter where you were from or what you looked like, you could share in the hope that tomorrow would be better, and that if you loved and cared for others, whatever your differences, you would ensure that the darkness never extinguished the light. Of course, Life Day isn't unique. Many planets and cultures have midwinter celebrations of their own, born from ancient times when people huddled on the coldest of nights, dreaming of the warmth of days to come. On Coruscant, there is solstice tide. On New Alderaan, there is the Festival of Winter's Heart. Wait, where's New Alderaan?
What is that? You know, that'd be a spoiler.
Okay. The Ewoks of the Sanctuary Moon of Endor tell tales of the White Fall, while the Mon Calamari celebrate the turning of the year's tide. Even the Hutts, wicked as so many of their number seem on the surface, mark the Funtan Acharakun, or the Festival of the Thousand Suns, when clan rivalries and blood feuds are forgotten, at least for one night, and revelry lasts until the dawn breaks on a new day. Whatever the lore, the celebrations themselves bear startling similarities. Gifts are exchanged and loved ones dine together, sharing feasts both grand and humble. There are songs and there are games. Dwellings are decorated and traditions observed, but most of all, there are stories shared with friends and relatives around crackling fires and flickering glow rods. Between these pages, you will find just a small selection of these festive tales, legends and myths that speak of love and kinship, peace and caring, and most important of all, hope for tomorrow. Here's to a happy Life Day for us all, now and forever.
The crowd goes wild.
Yay! And they have pictures for each of these, too.
Very, very nicely illustrated. Do you know what this book represents?
What?
One step closer to the holiday special being canon.
Yes.
And you know what? They're my kinds of stories because they're only like 20 pages long. That's my kind of book.
Oh, my goodness. That was really cool. All right. This is the back, by the way. Look at that.
And then in a few months, we'll have the Life Day cookbook.
Yes.
Oh, I know. So much Life Day. So maybe we can do something around reading one of these stories at our Life Day meetup.
Yeah.
Or a little reenactment.
Yeah, something. That might be fun.
Now we just need an angsty lumpy. It's funny. In the book, he's always on his data pad. Sound familiar?
Wow.
Looking at you teenagers.
Yeah, that I was going to say. Yeah. No longer millennials or teenagers. Mm-mm. No. All right. Well, wow. I can't wait. I'm going to pick that up after you're done.
Okay.
Now, the reason I have not picked up that book yet is because I was listening to Tempest Runner, which is an audio original by Kevin Scott. And it's from the High Republic series, and it's out today, August 31st.
Boy, this guy never sleeps, Captain Scott.
I know. So I was fortunate enough to receive a review copy of this. So I'm going to give you a brief spoiler-free review.
Okay.
Now, this is in the vein of Dooku. What is that? Jedi Lost, I believe.
Oh, right. The audio drama?
Yeah, the audio drama and also Sarah Kuhn's Dr. Aphra.
Okay.
Right? So This is an audio drama, which means it is voiced by a full cast.
Oh, so this wasn't a book. This is just an audio drama.
This is an audio drama. And it's a little different than some of the High Republic stuff we've gotten before, because High Republic has come out with novels, has come out with YA novels.
Comics.
And, like middle grade novels. So this is the first audio drama. And it's 6 hours and 6 minutes long. And it's a very rich story. Like, so here's the synopsis. Now, if you've been keeping up with the High Republic, you know that the Nile are the baddies. They're the bad guys. And the Nile are headed up by Marcion Roe. But there's three Tempest Runners that are directly under him, like in the hierarchy of the Nile. And each has their own storm or gang that they control. And it's like a huge, large gang. They're almost like independent states in how they run things. And Lorna D, well, she's a Twi'lek, and she's in charge of one of these storms. And in the latest novel, she proved to be the most intelligent and ruthless of the three of these Nile. So this audio drama follows her story and delves into her past, so we get to see how she became so ruthless and vicious and just this amazing kind of
vicious
scary
character.
Person. Yeah. Now, what's interesting about it is this is a bit like how Disney takes villains and tells their story. So you get like Maleficent or Cruella. Here we get to see Lorna D and how she ticks and her origin story as well. And I would give this audio drama a PG-13 rating. It's a little higher than like Maleficent or Cruella, because there's a fair amount of implied violence and gore. More so than any Disney villain movie, that's for sure. Now, you don't see it, but, you know, it's like, implied, and there's, like, punching noises and, you know, things like that, and cracking skulls and things, like, whoa. Oh. Yeah, it's a little like, whoa. There's some violence in there. We begin the story as Lorna is captured by the Jedi, but she has hidden her identity, and they don't know that they've actually caught the Lorna D. Locked into a Republic correctional ship, she's dragged across the galaxy to repair the very damage that she and her fellow Tempest Runners have inflicted on it. But as Lorna plans her glorious escape, she makes alliances that grow dangerously close to friendships. Outside the Nile, separated from her infamous ship, her terrifying arsenal, and her feared name, Lorna must carve her own path. But will it lead to redemption? Or will she emerge as a deadlier threat than ever before? Dun, dun, dun. Find out in 6 hours of the audio drama. So that's the synopsis. And now my spoiler-free review. You know, this is an audio drama, so it's all dialogue. So there's no descriptions of what's happening. You only glean what's happening through the dialogue, which is a little bit jarring at first, especially with this particular one, because there's so much happening that's very physical. Like, wait, I mentioned,
there's no narration.
There's no narration. It's all the dialogue between the characters. And Kevin Scott does a good job of weaving in, like, he starts in this bar where some guy is telling the story of Lorna, mm-hmm. right? And then it just kind of goes to her. So it starts in, like, a story form, but then it, like, jumps to her. And so while that's very well done, sometimes it's hard to visualize simply because we aren't getting that bigger picture or long shot.
So when they're cutting from different scenes,
right?
How do they segue?
With like music cues, things like that. Because it's an audio drama, they have a lot more music and sound effects and things like that. So like you cut from a ship in the present, which has a different sound than like a ship in the past, where there's no sound, or the bar where a guy is telling the story. You have like different sound beds, if you will.
Right.
So I think that's kind of does that. But that being said, the acting is great. I mean, the only way to distinguish characters is through their voices. And so the cast really does a great job in making each voice very distinct, I would say. my only caveat to this is for some reason there's a lot of breathing noises, and it's part of two characters in particular, but it can get a bit distracting. I think they were directed to be like, okay, be present in this scene. And so they would do things like, you know, like stuff like that. It kind of gets a little distracting.
So like heavy breathing, not like the Darth Vader breathing.
One character is a little Darth Vader-y, not quite as bad, but he's got some weird, like, I don't know what kind of alien
like
he is.
A respiratory issue.
Yes, he's got a respiratory issue. And I don't know what alien he is because, you know, they say that at, like, the very beginning and I forget as I'm listening to it. So, yeah.
Did they release the soundtrack to this? The actual music soundtrack?
No, there's not a music soundtrack.
I thought you said there was music in between scenes.
There's a music bed.
Okay.
But, like, it's what is it called? It's, like music of the scene.
Like, yeah, I know what you're, like, incidental music.
Yeah, stuff like that. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, just be aware of that. Overall, the story is very good. Like, Lorna is on this prison ship with a bunch of other women. So there's a lot of good, like, dialogue between females, which is nice. Mm-hmm. And I do recommend this as a different look at the High Republic, especially if you're already a fan of audiobooks. Because, you know, the audio drama really takes it up a notch from the audiobook. You just don't get those descriptions. That's the only thing. But Kevin Scott himself has written several audio dramas, and he began this in the UK where they're more popular. You know, he's written for various franchises like Doctor Who and things like that. And he also wrote Dooku Jedi Lost. And so, yeah, if you've enjoyed that, if you've enjoyed Sarah Kuhn's Dr. Aphra, if you just like audiobooks in general, I think you'd enjoy this too. Just be aware to pay close attention at the beginning so you kind of can get these characters' voices in your head at the beginning.
I'm glad you said that because I'm out. Because they'll mention something, and I've listened to audiobooks, and they'll say something, it's like, oh, that's pretty cool, and oh, I know what they're referring to. And by the time I get back to listening, we're 5 pages ahead.
Right.
I have to scrub back to the very beginning and find out. So I can't listen to audiobooks because I just have an issue with focus.
Yeah, this is definitely an audio drama that you have to really pay attention to as you would like reading a book in your hand. So yeah.
Okay.
There you go. But like I said, it's really cool to see the bad side of things, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
get into that.
Just have both points of view.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, Meredith... And this guy Chash is also pointing out there are kids' books, little kids' books in the High Republic multimedia project.
Yes, you're right.
And I love those because I can whip through those in a night. 10 pages, 5 words on a page.
I love it.
I can do maybe 1 or 2 of those in a night.
All right. And as a reminder, as we record this on August 31st, Tempest Runner is available. So go download it now.
Going by the cover of this, the picture.
That's really cool.
That is an awesome looking creature. And you know people will be cosplaying as that for the next celebration.
So that's Lorna D. She is a Twi'lek. Here, I'll make this bigger.
She's a Twi'lek?
Yeah, she's a Twi'lek.
Whenever you say Laura Dean, I think you're gonna say Lorna Dune, like the cookie. All right. With that, Sarah, let's get into some learning and things that we've learned from Star Wars, Disney, and the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
School days, dear old golden rule days.
Now, when I was a kid, I hated seeing the words back to school. Because this meant that school was starting up soon, and I wanted my summer vacation back. But now, let's give this a positive spin by discussing what we've learned from our favorite fandoms like Star Wars, Disney, MCU. If anyone's got something they learned from Harry Potter or Lord of the Rings, you know, by all means, jump right in there. And even after the fact, when you're listening to this show, if you have something that you've learned from a particular fandom, then by all means, tweet at us, put it in our Facebook group comment on this episode. We love to know what you've learned.
Yeah.
All right. So, Sarah, do you want to begin by telling everyone what you've learned by watching the Star Wars saga?
Okay. So we're going to start with the Star Wars franchise here. So I'm going to start with Luke's failure at the cave in The Empire Strikes Back. because this is a scene that took me years to understand. As a kid, it always confused me growing up. Like, his failure at the cave. I didn't understand how it was a failure, and I didn't understand why he didn't listen to Yoda when Yoda said, don't bring your stuff, right? Don't bring your lightsaber and things like that. It's like, well, Yoda's your teacher. You should listen to your teacher. So it just always confused me. And it wasn't until I was an adult that I understood. So Luke asks Yoda,
what's in there?
Only what you take with you.
That should be a clue right there, Luke.
Right. So Luke then goes into the cave and he experienced darkness and the horror of seeing himself as Vader in the cave because he was afraid. He was prepping for a fight by bringing his lightsaber, right? So he brought fear and darkness into the cave, and that is what he got out of it. So equate this to us embarking on any new journey, like going to an event, going to a new job, going to a Star Wars celebration. And often you get out of it what you take with you in your mental state. And that's what the cave is in a lot of these like hero's journey cycles. The cave is like representing what is going on in your mind. And so, like I said, it took me years to like figure this out, but...
Now, did you ever use this knowledge in a real life incident?
Well, yeah, anytime, especially at conventions, I think, because I think when you're prepping for conventions, especially like D23 Expo or Star Wars Celebration, where they've just become more and more popular, where it's just getting harder and harder to manage the crowds and everything, right? Like, I always get a little anxiety, like, oh, am I going to get into the panel I want? Or am I going to get into this... a store I want, you know, all this stuff. You always have an agenda in your head. And if you just kind of like take a deep breath before you go the day and be like, you know what, whatever happens will be good. Like it's meant to happen or, you know, something like that. Then that is what you will get out of the day. And I specifically remember a D23 Expo, I think it was 2013 even. And I was dressed as Tangled. I was dressed as Rapunzel, and I was trying to get to this one panel, and it just got full, and I couldn't get to it. So I went on the main floor, and they were having these random pop-up panels on the main floor, and one of them happened to be a merchandising panel for Disney products, where they were talking about the Disney dolls. And they gave away like this Rapunzel doll, and I was dressed as Rapunzel in the front row, and like I learned all this cool stuff about merchandising and how they make these dolls and things, and then I won the toy. So like it was awesome because I just was like, okay, well, I'm not going to pout in the corner because I didn't make this panel. I'm going to go find something else to do.
Nice.
Yeah.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good example.
Yeah. So what about you, Richard?
I'm going to go to The Mandalorian.
Ooh, okay.
And we all love the expression, this is the way. But I loved it when Din Djarin learned, no, this is not the way. There's other ways. There's other ways of looking at this. And there's just more. There's always more than just one way of seeing something or believing in one way. It's okay that others see the same thing, but differently.
I love that.
And I've got a friend in particular whose name I'm not going to mention that will look at the same thing, get to the same goal, but we may come at it from a very different angle. And sometimes you can be like, no, Rich, no. It's this way. It's like, no, if my way works, then this is my way. So I love the fact that slowly but surely Din Djarin was learning this.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to be open to that. And I think when we first saw that on The Mandalorian, I think everyone on social media said, look, see, there is other ways of looking at things. You don't have to be upset because someone's not looking at it your way, because not everyone's got the same experience as you. I have a maybe... If we're looking at something like the Life Day stories. I'm looking at it from the holiday special angle, and someone else is looking at it through a Christmas angle. Someone else is looking at it through the family angles, all with different angles, but yet it gets to the same point. And I think that was a brilliant move on their part. And I don't know if they had, if the producers or Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni had thought of this in the very beginning, or just kind of wound up this way, that this is not the way. They made a big deal about this is the way. We had t-shirts made. It was a fun thing to say. Then all of a sudden, they flipped the script on us. And we realized, you know what? You're right. You're right. Whatever experience you have, that is your way. Mm-hmm. And I just love that.
I like that. That's a really good point to bring up.
All right. Give us one more from Star Wars.
Okay.
Wait, hold on. Oh, Justin Smith in the Sky Chat is saying, do or do not, there is no try. Now, I think that's like the number one lesson to learn from Star Wars. When I first heard that in 1980 while seeing The Empire Strikes Back, I remember my jaw going, truer words were never spoken. And whenever someone would say, I'm going to try to do this, even as an 11-year-old, I would say, no, 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 don't try. Because if you say you're going to try, then you're leaving room for failure. Say you're going to do, affirm it. Affirm the fact that you're going to do it.
Nice.
Thank you, Justin.
All right. Well.
Oh, hold on, hold on. Eric is here. Eric Unkenhout. Guess what? Today's his birthday.
Oh!
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Eric. Happy birthday to you.
Do you like your off-key rendition of happy birthday?
Eric Unkenhout in the house, birthday boy, taking out some time and watching us.
Woohoo!
Watching our live recording.
Yay!
I'm sorry, I was off key. Okay. I was told that many times today.
I love you, sweetie. I love you.
All right, so tell us what else did you learn, Sarah, from Star Wars?
Okay, well, so I learned happy beeps. So, like Poe says to BB-8, when BB-8's worrying about, you know, attacking Starkiller Base, or, you know, he's being a worrywart, you know, Poe says happy beeps. Basically, focus on the good and a good outcome. Mm-hmm. It's kind of similar to the failure at the cave, but a little bit different. You know, like, it's kind of something you can use as a mantra every day. Just happy beeps, you know? And then all of a sudden, it kind of puts you in a good mood because you're like, oh, happy beeps.
Well, then you think about BB-8 and all his beeping.
Yes. It's it's so happy.
Exactly. How do you get in a bad... It's like hearing a child laugh.
I love it. Yes. Yes, it is. Oh. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, there you go.
All right.
Richard, do you have something else to share?
There's so much to share, but I'll just go with one more.
Okay.
And then we'll move on to Disney because...
Well, we'll move on to our Skywalker comments.
Okay, okay. Now, this one comes from the Clone Wars. And they teach, don't be another brick in the wall. Just like Pink Floyd sang a long time ago, don't be just another brick in the wall. Like the clones taught us, stand apart. They made their helmets unique. And they had a big challenge because not only do they all look alike underneath, but their armor all looks alike. But they modified it so you know who is who because they made each of their helmets unique to their personality. And I love that. If clones can stand out, then you can stand out. Be unique. Don't be another brick in the wall. Don't be just one in the masses. Stand out. Say your piece. Let the world know you're here. And I know each one of us has got something to say. Even if you think, what I have to say is not really worth it, but how do you know? We don't know what your experiences are, so you may come at this situation or any situation from a whole unique angle, and here we come back to the unique angle. Tell us how you are different, and I'm sure that's going to be celebrated because so many people, working with a lot of young kids, they just want to be another brick in the wall. They don't want to stand out.
And no.
You know what? When you're a young kid, you do just want to be one of those.
Well, because you don't know who you are yet.
Exactly. But those kids who say, you know what, I'm going to speak out, I got something to say, those are the kids who are going to be remembered, and you know those kids are going to get somewhere. Mm-hmm. Now, there are those kids who internalize and they think things through, so there's many levels. But I'm just saying, on a whole, make your presence known. Make your presence known. Growing up, I was always the quiet kid.
Me too.
Yeah. And I hated it. I hated my seventh grade teacher, last day of school, I said something and he said, "Who are you?"
Oh my gosh.
The last day of school, he asked me who I was because I never spoke up. Oh. And at that point, I realized, wow, I don't want to be forgotten. I don't want to be someone who people just I don't want to be an extra in the game of life.
Right.
I want to be somebody. Just like in the movie The Jerk with Steve Martin, be somebody.
See that? Be somebody.
Well, I'll show you the movie later on.
I've seen it once. All right. Yes,
now, that whole movie's theme is be somebody.
Does he have a long nose in that movie?
No, that's Roxanne.
Okay. Okay, I don't remember. All right, cool. All right.
So we put this question on our Facebook group and asked all you Skywalkers, hey, what did you learn from Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel?
Yes. Now, if you're in the Sky Chat right now, you can share what you've learned from Star Wars. And as we're reading, we'll get to your comments as well. But my mom, Norma, wrote from Empire Strikes Back.
Do. Or do not. There is no try.
Every day we are faced with challenges, and this quote always reminds me to push forward in whatever task is at hand. So yes, thank you, Mom.
Yeah, one of the best quotes, I think, from not just any Star Wars film, but from any film.
Yes.
All right, Rex Gordon says, first, make the girl says she loves you first. Then say something like, you know, sometimes I amaze even myself. It's all about the style.
Rex, we want to know, has that worked for you? Inquiring minds want to know.
All right, William Magalio said, I am constantly learning from Disney, Star Wars, and Marvel to live your best life, face your challenges head on, get back up when you fall.
There you go.
And there you go, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, that is another great piece of advice. You'll always get knocked down in life.
Yes.
And just pick yourself up, learn from that experience, use that, and move on. And the next time, it won't be so easy to knock you down.
Mm-hmm. I do love TRBE on Instagram responded and said, Jedis come in all shapes and sizes. That's right. Judge me by my size, you will not, right?
Judge me by my size, do you?
Mm-hmm. I actually, being a short person, I sometimes get that, like, because we do team sports sometimes, like water volleyball, and I played soccer growing up, and so, like, people tended to judge me, like, oh, she's not, you know, she's gonna be easy to get around or whatever, but no, I surprise people.
Mm-hmm.
In soccer,
you surprise
I was
me.
That's right. In soccer, I became the wall. No one could get past me on defense, and yeah, so. It, and then water volleyball, I just come shooting out of the water sometimes. It's
like
really
a
fun.
Dolphin.
It's really awesome.
Now, there's a lot of great comments here
in the
Sky Chat.
Yes.
All right. Eric says, like Carrie Fisher said, be afraid, but do it anyway.
I love
that. Wow. That's a showstopper right there.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're not afraid, then you're going to skate through something and not try as hard. Like every show, every live show we do, there's that little anxiety. And if that weren't there, I'd be worried.
Oh.
It's like, oh, because being having a little anxiety, a little fright will keep you on your toes.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it keeps you on your toes. Yes.
Yes, yes. And all the best entertainers, I mean, like the like Adam Carolla, my favorite, he says he's no matter what he's doing, he's always got that little bit of fear that always keeps him so sharp. And there isn't anyone I know who's sharper than Adam Carolla.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have Courtney Turkell who says, from Star Wars, I learned to have faith in something bigger than yourself, like Luke had faith in the Force to hit the center of the Death Star without looking.
Mm.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
I love that, Courtney.
Yeah. Too many people doubt themselves.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and Din, hey, Din's with us.
Yeah.
He just came back from a tour.
Wow.
He says, oh, your focus determines your reality from The Phantom Menace. He says, that's my all-time favorite. That is the most powerful thing you can do to empower somebody. Help make them aware that they can create their entire reality of life with just their mind.
Wow.
And that's... Wow, yeah, these are all showstoppers.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you go into something being too afraid or predicting the outcome, oh, I'm going to be horrible at this is going to be terrible. Well, guess what? You're going to be terrible at this.
Right.
Because your focus determined how this is going to end up. And believe us, we're not just spitting in the wind here. These things we've learned ourselves. And having been a live entertainer for almost 30 years now, a lot of this so rings true.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's see. Meredith says, never tell me the odds. You just don't want to know, right, Meredith?
You know what? Doesn't matter because I'm still going to do it.
Now, Chuck Couch has joined us. He says, Star Wars taught me to have hope in all situations.
Yeah.
I love, yes,
mm-hmm.
Hope. The last line of Rogue One.
Yeah,
hope.
Said by Princess Leia.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you're just going to give up, well, guess what? That's going to determine your reality.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to read something from Brian Sims here, who wrote a very heartfelt comment on Instagram. He says, Star Wars has and is still teaching me the joy of immersing yourself into a passion. It's a wonderful release from the stress of the real world. As a child, it taught me how to play with others in the wonderful world of Kenner Star Wars toys. It taught me people from different walks of life can come together under the umbrella of fandom. In a bigger picture, it has taught me how to navigate the ugly side of social media and fandom by seeking out only the most positive aspects of what you enjoy. Star Wars continues to teach me lessons in life through its storytelling and by the amazing people I continue to meet along the way, like you, Richard and Sarah. Aww.
Oh, thank you there, Brian.
Thank you.
All right. Justin Smith. Oh, he's quoting Disney over here.
Ooh.
And from Scrooge McDuck, work smarter, not harder. This is another argument I have with another unnamed friend. You know who you are. Yeah, I don't want to say names because I want to protect the guilty.
Okay. All right, so Alan Sanborn, with a last-minute comment here, writes in, one of the main things that Star Wars taught me was that anything is possible. As a kid who was very into science fiction and fantasy books, I just didn't believe that most of them could be done effectively on film. Star Wars blew me away because it seemed to have no limits as to what it could show us. The mixture of high adventure storytelling and great special effects was stunning, and it was after seeing Star Wars that I became interested in filmmaking as my medium of choice to tell my stories.
Nice. And Alan's a great filmmaker.
Cool.
That's how I met him, through fan films. All right, now this, just saying what Star Wars has taught us can fill out an entire podcast series.
Right.
So this is just the tip of that Hoth iceberg.
Exactly. So now we are going to move on to Disney and what Disney has taught us. Now, specifically, because Disney is a giant umbrella now, we're just talking about, like, the Disney films or the theme
park. Disney
and Pixar, really.
Right.
Right. Yeah, Disney proper. Because Marvel will be next. So there you have it. So, Richard, do you want to start us off with a Disney-ism?
Just keep swimming.
Just keep swimming. Just keep swimming. Just keep swimming. Swimming, swimming.
I loved when I first heard that because you can't get any more basic than that. When life just throws stuff at you and things are just impossible and you just don't think you can go on, guess what? You just got to keep on swimming. Don't give up. Don't drown. Because if you stop swimming, that's what you're going to do. You're going to sink and drown. Just keep swimming because you're going to get to the end of that situation, that experience, whatever you're going through. And it'll be all right because you look for that silver lining. This was horrible, horrible, horrible. But I learned something about myself and how to deal with the situation next time.
Mm-hmm.
So always look for that silver lining. And when you keep on swimming, that's what you're going to do. And you look back and you figure out, okay, what made that so difficult? What can I do next time so that won't be difficult? Got it. I'm going to keep on swimming until this happens again, and I'll be doing the backstroke. That's how easy this is going to be. I'll be doing the puppy paddle.
The breaststroke.
Yeah, the puppy paddle.
Okay.
So that's my favorite all-time Disney lesson.
I like that. I love that. And that's a great film, too. But now, Skywalkers in the Sky Chat right now, if you have a Disney like lesson you've learned, please share it here. All right, so my Disney is from Rapunzel, because that's what I'm representing today. So Rapunzel, I feel that we've learned to live your dream. And don't be afraid to live your dream, because in the film, she was afraid that once she found her dream, like, what do I do? What if it's... I've got my dream, now what?
I've been looking out a window for 18 years, dreaming about what I might feel like when those lights rise in the sky. What if it's not everything I dreamed it would be?
It will be.
And what if it is? What do I do then?
Well, that's the good part, I guess. You get to go find a new dream.
You can never have too many dreams. So that is what I've learned from Rapunzel, and I feel that we've managed to do that, live our dream.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Because if you don't, you're going to regret it.
Yes.
Now I'm going to piggyback off of that and go with another life lesson I learned from Tangled. Step outside your bubble.
Oh, that's a good one.
Oh, when she stepped on that grass, that was her first step into a larger world.
That always makes me cry.
Yeah, oh, it does.
That
because,
song.
Because it's that feeling of accomplishment. Like, this is not my security blanket here, but I'm going to do it anyway. And when I succeed, I'm going to feel fantastic, because I'll have learned that my bubble can get bigger and bigger and bigger and never pop. Because I'm always expanding it, and it's always going to be here. And that was one of my, another favorite lessons when I first saw Tangled. It's like, oh, look at her. Look how much fun she's having. Even though she would go, this is the best day ever. Then she'd be going in remorse. Best day ever, remorse.
This is so fun!
I am a horrible daughter. I'm going back.
That's what's going to happen, because it's not your security blanket. You don't feel safe.
Right.
Which is why a lot of these big, like, self-help improvement seminars are always done, like, out of the country. Somewhere where no one has their surroundings to keep them safe. Like those Timothy Robbins?
I don't know.
That guy. Yeah, he was big in, like, the 90s.
Zig Ziglar is all I know. My mom read some books.
What? No. Yeah, so when they had these big self-help seminars, it would always be somewhere far away, so you wouldn't have your bubble.
Interesting.
Love it. And let's read a comment here from the Sky Chat. Din says, okay, I just want to hear Richard keep singing. Thank you, Din. See, someone appreciates off-key singing. Baskin Robbins, Eric says.
What?
Is that Timothy Robbins?
Oh, what? What are we talking about?
Oh, Timothy Robbins. That's Tim Robbins from Howard the Duck. Dang
what?
It. Who is this? This is going to drive me crazy now. Timothy Robbins. Come on. Someone help me out here.
All right. You know what? We've got some great comments from Skywalkers coming up, but I'm going to tell you that I'm going to go to a Pixar film, and it is Inside Out. And I learned a lot of cool things from Inside Out. One is, I just love how they map.
Tony Robbins! I'm sorry. It's Tony Robbins.
Okay.
Not Baskin Robbins, not Timothy Robbins.
Okay. Tony Robbins.
I can sleep tonight.
Okay.
So I'm so sorry. My bad.
All right. Well, so as I was saying, Inside Out. I love Inside Out. It's just an amazing film. And also, that's another one where, you know, focus on the joy or the sadness, or learn how to incorporate the two into your own personality, or, you know, fear or anger, or I think joy, sadness, fear, anger, disgust. There you go. All right. But I love how they mapped the human brain and you have these islands of personality. This really stood out to me. I love this idea that we each have these identities based on the stuff we love. So Riley in the film, she's the 11-year-old girl. She loves hockey, family. She has goofball island, friendship island. And like throughout the film, as she's like, you know, she's moved to a new city, so she doesn't have her friends. And she ran away from home, so her family is not there, right? And then the hockey is disappearing because there's not a hockey team there in San Francisco like there was in Minnesota. So the islands are starting to disintegrate. And I feel that we all have these islands that have shifted or disintegrated or created new ones as we change and grow. So think about your past. Like, I know I had soccer island, and while I feel like I still know how to play soccer, I think it's probably more of a black and white island now, you know? It's not as kept up as it was when I was my teenage years, right? And now we have water volleyball island, right?
Oh, there you go.
So some islands have faded, but others have grown stronger. Like our family island keeps on growing. So Richard, what's an island that you think maybe you had that maybe you don't have anymore?
I don't know. I get the same interest I did when I was 7 years old. I've got this notebook somewhere. It's not a trapper keeper, but I've written down all my interests, and I have on there Star Wars, I have Planet of the Apes, The Monkees, Batman, Spider-Man. Cut to 2021, what are my biggest interests right now?
All those.
Star Wars, Planet of the Apes, Monkees.
Maybe not Batman as much.
Yeah, I like me some Batman.
Okay.
Spider-Man, so when you were just talking, it's like, oh, I don't really have... I don't know. I'm still the 7-year-old.
Well, that's interesting. So your islands are like mountains now. Your islands are mountains. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah.
They've grown.
Okay. I like it. Yeah, we have got Podcast Island, right?
Yeah, there you go.
So I love that. I just think that's a cool way to think about it. And I just, inside out, really cool.
It's a very, very cool movie. All right. Let me throw in one more here because I still haven't mastered this one. Hakuna Matata.
Oh, yeah.
It means no worries. Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata. Ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your day.
Don't worry about the unavoidable. And that's me all over the place. That's all I do is worry about the unavoidable. And I just can't stop myself. And I know, logically, it's like, why are you worrying about that? All right, it's going to happen. There's nothing to worry about. You just get done with it. Like, if you got a very busy weekend, oh, I got so many things I got to do. You know it's going to happen. And you know you'll get to the other side of it. So don't worry about it. And I just can't get past this.
Well, you know what? I think we make a good team. Because, because I probably more embody the Hakuna Matata mentality. And so we kind of balance each other out. Because sometimes I can be a bit too, like, lackadaisical, I think.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So there you go. So,
okay, yeah. It's all about living in the present. Just know these problems will be solved one way or another.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, Shamim says islands in his head are Star Wars, Dinosaur Island, and Harry Potter Island. I love it.
Those are some good islands.
I love it. Now, we had some great comments on social media about Disney. So I'm going to read this from Courtney Turkell. When I was young, it was all about Bambi and the golden rule of, if you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all. Thumper learned that lesson. Now, Courtney goes on, as I got older, Lion King gave me a great lesson in the past can hurt, but you can either run from it or you can learn from it. And
just
then
keep swimming.
Yes. And then there's the overarching lesson of Disney in general with always follow your dreams. But the most important one today is from Once Upon a Time with
all magic comes with a price.
Yeah, I can see that, especially as adults.
Yeah.
Like, Yeah, magic comes at a price.
Nothing, you know, nothing is for free. Something's too good, chances are there's going to be a hitch.
Courtney, are you also talking about magic keys and things? I think that's funny. Like, literally. Mm-hmm. Disney magic comes at a price. Right?
Yeah, that's true to life.
I know. All right.
All right.
Did you want to read
one? Well, Melissa Miller, she writes, loved that true love in Frozen was sisters and not some random dudes you just met.
And how they made fun of that. Yeah. That was funny.
That was hysterical.
Yes.
When these films could be so self-referential.
Yes.
Love it. And now let's read one from Kelly Turkel.
Let me read this. I'll read the next two. Kelly says, I was just thinking about this with World Princess Week and how each princess has taught me something different. Belle was strong-willed. Ariel was curious. Snow White was compassionate. Jasmine, confident. Pocahontas was brave. Cinderella had a work ethic. Tinkerbell was protective. Disney taught me how to be me. And although I didn't see it when I was younger, I get it now. I like that, Kelly. That's very, very good. Wow. All right. And then I want to read something by Meredith Duckworth, which it gave me goosebumps. So I think everything can trace back to spoonful of sugar and whistle while you work. Sometimes just changing your outlook can change your situation. I love that, right?
Oh, yeah.
I do that so many times. And to balance that, you have the next right thing from Frozen 2. When changing your outlook isn't enough, you keep moving until you can. The hero's journey across all three tells that you're still in the game as long as you keep moving forward.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great because you've got to keep moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
Hakuna Matata. Just keep moving on. Learn while you're going on, but just take all that experience, put it in your backpack, and use it when you need it.
Yeah.
Don't forget it.
Yeah, and Meredith, I've used those lessons like when I was going through a bad breakup before Richard.
I hope so.
It was before you. And it was just really bad. And I had to go to work every day, but I would like get myself all nice, prettied up, put on pretty makeup because it just made me feel better. And so when I got to work and everyone like treated me nice because I looked nice, you know, that's what happens. And so I just felt better all day because I had just spruced myself up and given myself a little bit of an outlook change.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Don't dwell on the darkness.
Yeah.
All right. Let's read this last one here from Jeremy Stevenson before moving on to Marvel. He writes, I'm going with The Lion King on this one. Be true to yourself. You can't run from your problems. Yes, the past hurts, but you can adapt and move on. True friends will stick with you. Always remember who you are. And yes, Hakuna Matata.
Now you have to say always remember who you are as James Earl Jones.
Remember who you are.
And the force is with you, young Simba. But you are not a lion yet.
All right, Chuck Couch has also chimed in the Sky Chat. All our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. I go to Disney World every month, and it's always been an escape, a moment to reset and treasure the moments and memories.
Mm-mm-mm.
Nice.
All right, now let's move on to Marvel. What has Marvel taught us? All right, talking to you, Sarah, and the Skywalkers in the Sky Chat.
Okay, yes, we want to know your Marvel stories. Right now, I'm going to actually go with something I learned while talking about Marvel shows, specifically WandaVision. I learned all about the five stages of grief from WandaVision, and it was just really fascinating. And this goes to show that it's not just what the characters say, but you can learn more by analyzing the show with others. And I think so many of us who attended the Zoom chats and things, like, we got so much more out of the show because we talked with each other, we analyzed it. Like, it was just, like, the best time. And I'm so glad we, recorded these, too. Mm-hmm. Because, and I just learned so much, and then I learned so much about some of my friends, too, who have to deal with grief as well. A lot, you know, they deal with it on a much more regular basis. So it helped me, it taught me about that.
Nice. Okay, good. I'm going to say You don't have to do it alone. All right? Teamwork. Teamwork. If you're in a situation, don't be afraid to ask for help. Reach out. Look at all the Avengers. They had that teamwork, and they were able at one point to thwart the evil oppressors up until Thanos. But then again, they worked together, and they conquered Thanos. Look at Guardians of the Galaxy. Star-Lord thought, I can do this alone. I don't need anybody else. It wasn't true, Star-Lord. Look around you. You need your friends, because each one carries that certain, like we said earlier, that certain experience level that combined, like the Infinity Gauntlet, makes a very, very powerful, I don't want to say weapon, but a powerful unity.
Yeah. Yeah. Like working together, working you can together, overcome anything. I think that's why Guardians of the Galaxy is like one of my top two favorites, because it shows like that moment when they're all like holding the stones together, and the moment when Groot is protecting them, right?
And he says, why are you doing this, Groot?
We are Groot. Yeah.
Yes.
That's amazing. I love it.
Yeah. I think nothing says teamwork like the Marvel films.
Yeah. Oh, it's making me cry. I love it. Well, I've also learned, can I share another thing
please.
That I've learned? So I've learned that friends and equals and colleagues like make the best partners in life. And I feel we learned this from Captain America, the First Avenger, and also the new What If episode 1. And it's the love story between Peggy Carter and Captain America. I feel that it really resonates because they had already connected on this personal level when Steve was skinny Steve, right? And the new What If episode makes it clear that they connected even when Peggy became the First Avenger instead of Steve. And it was their personalities that connected. And the fact that they both were in unique situations, you know, like Peggy being higher up in the management of the army and she's a woman, you know, that's a very different perspective. Same with Steve as being the only First Avenger. Or you flip that around for the What If episode. And they just formed this bond for life, no matter what they looked like. And I feel that, like, that teaches you that you really have to look beyond what a person looks like and into their personality and how it connects with yours. So, I feel like we learned that from the Marvel films as well.
Oh, sure did. All right, I'm going to go with my next one with find your superpower and use it for good. Because every one of us has got that one thing that they do exceptionally well, and you can use that for good. Look at everyone when we do the ForceFest or the Star Wars events with lining up. Those people, they found a niche in their life where they can raise money to help kids, to help people. They found their superpower, and they've used it for the greater good. And I love seeing the stories from the Make-A-Wish Foundation and Starlight Children's Foundation where you see where all your hard work goes to. And these kids are out, they're at Disneyland, or they're just enjoying a day at the park playing with each other because people were able to raise money for them. And it's not just about raising money. That's just one example. But whatever you can do, we'll go back to doing our live shows. And I love it when parents come over to me and say, we saw you last year doing your show, and my kid has learned some morals from your puppet show.
Yeah.
It's like, oh. And I when I hear that, I just want to just increase that superpower and just use it for good every chance I can get.
Yeah. Nice.
So we're all superheroes.
I love it. All right. We got some great comments here in the Sky Chat. So Shamim says, with great power comes great responsibility. Mm-hmm. From Stan Lee, of course.
Yeah, and that's one of the greatest Spider-Man quotes ever.
It really is. Justin Smith says, in Marvel, I learned don't collect all 7 Infinity Stones / 6 Infinity Stones. But that's okay, Justin. Yeah, 6 or 7, bad. Don't do it.
just throw them in a drawer. Use them for a paperweight.
Yes. Ooh, Courtney says, from Marvel, I have learned that a hero is someone that does the hard thing even if they don't want to. For example, Black Widow sacrificing herself so they could get the Soul Stone in Endgame.
Jeez.
Yeah.
There's the ultimate.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimate act of heroism.
Meredith says Marvel really leans on the importance of choice and how one choice can change everything. What if episodes right now? And we have some comments from all of our Skywalkers here from social media for the week.
All right. Eric Unkenhout says, I learned from Star Wars and Marvel that everyone needs help at some point. No one can do everything themselves, so don't be afraid to ask for help or offer help to those in need.
Oh, that's like your teamwork.
Yeah. Yeah. Great minds, Eric. Yeah. Great minds.
Shamim. Okay, so now we had a few people who responded with like everything they learned from Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel. Mm-hmm. So we're going to read some of these.
Yeah, all right. Shamim, he wrote, Toy Story, all about friendship.
Aww.
Oh. And Shamim is one of the greatest friends you can have.
Absolutely.
One of the most loyal people I've ever known.
Yeah. Okay, so Teresa writes, from Star Wars, she learned, boop, doop, be-doop, boop, boop. That's what R2 says, of course. Right?
Or was that BB-8?
And then from Disney, she learned, parents, who needs parents? Everyone. And by that, she means that Disney always kills off the parents, but you really do need your parents. And from Marvel, she says, Wakanda forever is literally my mantra. Very nice.
Is Teresa from Wakanda? I did not know that.
She likes to say it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Brianna Jones says she learned that you can rise up like Rey and Captain Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
From Star Wars and Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Yeah. When you're knocked down, get yourself back up and do what? Just keep swimming, swimming, swimming.
I'm reminded in the Captain Marvel film, remember when they kept showing her... Captain Marvel as a little girl and then slowly gradually growing up and how she was knocked to the ground and kept getting up and getting up and getting up. That what do you call that when you put a bunch of things together, a bunch of clips together in one
montage?
Thank you. The montage of the girls getting up.
Yeah.
That's such a powerful, powerful montage.
Oh yeah.
Because it's just showing you the message, not telling.
You're always going to get knocked down no matter who you are, no matter what you're doing. You're always going to get knocked down. Don't stay down.
Nope.
Get up.
Yep.
Get up.
Love it. Ooh.
Oh, Tasha. Tasha just joined us from New York. And
and wants to know, this is what they've learned from Marvel.
Okay. Giving a hostess fruit pie to a villain can save the day.
On that note.
Where do you go from there?
We don't know. We go to shoutouts.
Shoutouts. Skywalker shoutouts. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
All right, now for this shout out, let's focus on something that Alan Sanborn said about our last episode. This is the Rolling Stone episode. And he writes, I really enjoyed this episode. Before I listened to it, I thought that surely you weren't going to spend the whole episode on this Rolling Stone article, but you pretty much did, and I won't call you Shirley. And what I loved was both how much detail you went into about it, and especially how much enthusiasm you had about it, which really took me right back to when it first came out, and all of this inside information we were getting back then about Star Wars, for more or less the first time, was absolutely mind-blowing. I think this may have really been the first big confirmation that there would be a sequel, and even more excitingly, multiple sequels. Thanks for capturing that summer of 1977 excitement for me again.
Aww.
Wow.
That's cool.
If we can help someone capture the excitement of 1977, our job is done.
Absolutely. Thank you, Alan. All right, and now this is the first episode of September, which means Skywalking Force, it is time to shout you out. So the Skywalking Force is our Patreon, and we have to thank you all so much for supporting us each and every month. You guys are amazing. So without further ado, thank you to Wayne Kwong,
Blessed Cheesemaker,
Darren Irvine,
Patty Nazarian,
Courtney and Kelly Turkel,
Carol Cantwell,
William Magalio,
John Liang,
Dave Kerwin,
Patty Hammond,
John Zancanaro,
Nancy Steinman,
Michael Corbett,
Scott Hume,
Glenn Stein,
Carl Fox,
Dora Speck,
Julie Caruana,
Jeff Long,
Garrett Sessions,
Derek Beeb,
Jennifer Cole,
Mike Ward,
Terry Lee,
Bryn McKinnon,
Chickafent,
Wynn Patterson,
Patrick Pine,
Peter and Norma Heitman, my parents,
The Hunt Family,
Mike Sanders,
Scott Carmichael,
Laura Bryce,
Anthony,
Reynold Gobet,
and Christopher Marino.
Yay.
Thank you to one and to all.
Yes, and you guys, thank you so much. If anyone is interested in joining the Skywalking Force for bonus content and other fun items, you can head to skywalkingforce.com.
Well, that wraps up episode 340 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
And we want to dedicate this episode to our bunny Hoojib, who just joined the Force last Saturday.
He did.
Oh, well, yeah. He's now living peacefully with the other Force Ghost bunnies.
Yeah.
We had him for about seven years, which is a long time for a bunny.
It really is.
Yeah.
And he had a very happy life, and yeah, he's a good little bunny, a good little Hoojib. It's interesting that happened right when Hoojibs were becoming a thing. It's like, oh.
But he was having some issues, so I think
He's happier now. Yeah. Yeah.
We want to thank to those who sent us a big box of Susie cakes to help us through this hard time.
Yes, thank you. Oh my goodness. Wow, you guys are amazing, so thank you.
All right. Now, if we don't keep on going on, we're both going to break down.
I know, okay.
We want to thank all you Skywalkers for weighing in on everything that we do here at the Skywalking Network. And,
and
thanks for joining our live stream today.
Yeah, and we love all your comments. We could not do this show without you. And once again, every Tuesday at 5 p.m., that's when we have our live stream. So we love that you join us. So please, Skywalkers, a reminder, if you're watching us live, this Wednesday is when we're going to go over Marvel What If, episodes 3 and 4.
Yes.
And we're going to do both of those this Wednesday because Fridays are booked right now. We're going to see John Williams at the Hollywood Bowl. So that's going to be exciting. So we have to do the What If this Wednesday at 6:30 p.m.
6:30 p.m.
Pacific.
So we won't have any kind of Zoom discussion on Friday.
Right.
We're going to do it on Wednesday, but then we'll resume the Friday after that.
Yes. All right. And we will also remind you in the newsletter. So you can sign up for our newsletter by clicking in the link in our show notes or heading to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and look for the tab, sign up for our newsletter, or the widget on the side. And I know a couple of you have signed up in the past week, so please, more signups. We would love that. Now, we'd also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations, for their continued support. Are you thinking of a trip to Disney parks? There's some good deals right now. Are you thinking of a cruise? There's a Halloween cruise that needs to be filled, so good deals. You can fill out a Get a Quote form at smallworldvacations.com today. Their vacation planning service is free, so check it out and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
Now, do you love Skywalking Through Neverland?
I do.
Do you love all the Marvel and Star Wars shows coming to Disney Plus?
Of course.
Well, consider becoming a member of the Skywalking Force, which is our Patreon. Here, we are posting all of our Disney Plus Zoom chats as audio podcasts.
Including the WandaVision chats that I mentioned. Mm-hmm. So, great to go back. That bonus content begins at only $5 a month, so head to skywalkingforce.com. And thank you once again to those of you who are part of the Skywalking Force.
love you all. Now, we are part of the Skywalking Network.
Skynet.
This is one of my favorite parts of the show because that's when Courtney and Kelly put in the Sky Chat. They whisper Skynet in the Sky Chat. We're...
Eric. Oh my God!
Eric joined in there too.
Everyone's doing it. Well, what's on Skynet?
Well, you can find other great shows like Talking Apes,
Classic Marvel Star Wars Comics,
The Max Effects Podcast,
The Neverland Clubhouse,
Resilience Squadron,
Totally Tell Me Everything,
Star Warsologies,
and the YouTube show Collectopolis.
Boy, I think every one of these has got a show in production right now.
Yes, they do. You can find us on social media, where we often reach out to you for questions that, you know, we talk about on the show. And we are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter and Instagram and TikTok. And you can join our Facebook group. So just search Facebook for Skywalking, request to join, answer questions. I believe there's 3 questions, so don't forget to scroll. And you can email share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. You can also, if you want to share something you've learned from Star Wars, Disney, or Marvel, you can either write to us, or you can record a voice memo on your phone, and from there you can email that to share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. We might play it on the next episode.
Love to hear that. Well, even Shamim is chiming in with Skynet.
Yes.
Now, don't forget to stick around for bloopers and other little fun bits that didn't make it into the show. And
always remember
to grab your protractor, your compass, your trapper keeper,
and your number 2 pencil.
And
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Ogushewitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
So I'm going to hit record.
We have notes this time? We never run on notes. And a script. And an agenda.
Oh.
And a blueprint.
Okay, shh. Hush.
Hakuna Matata.